Pleasant good morning to everyone. We're now about to commence the funeral service for Brother Calvin Winston Sobers. Jesus said, I am the resurrection and I am the life. He who believes in me, though he die, yet shall he live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His compassion never fails. Every morning they are renewed. Jesus said, let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. I am sure that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. If we live, we live to the Lord, and if we die to the Lord. So then whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. For to this end Christ died and lived again, that he might be Lord both of the dead and of the living. We brought nothing into the world and we take nothing out. The Lord gives and the Lord takes away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. The eternal God is our refuge, and underneath are the everlasting arms. We shall sing the hymn, Lead Us, Heavenly Father, Lead Us. With you. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, in your Son, Jesus Christ, you have given us a true faith and a sure hope. Strengthen this faith and hope in us all our days, that we may live as those who believe and trust in the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, and the resurrection to eternal life through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. We shall now have the reading of the Bible lesson.
Good morning, everyone. The Bible lesson is taken from John chapter 14, verses 1 to 6. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house, there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again. I will take you to myself, so that where I am, there you may be also. And you know the way to the place where I'm going." Thomas said to him, "Lord, we do not know where we are going. How can we know the way?" Jesus said to him, "I am the way, the truth, the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." Here ends the reading.
Thanks be to God. The hymn, "Through All the Changing Scenes of Life." We shall now have a tribute by Colin Cumberbatch.
Good morning, everyone. Let me start by saying that this is an occurrence which is I'm not entirely comfortable with. My grandmother would have had 3 children. A few years ago, I eulogized my aunt. This morning, I'm going to eulogize my uncle. And I am almost absolutely sure that if I should outlive my mother, I will also be asked to eulogize her. I think that one of my other siblings should start preparing themselves to fall into that role. Anyhow, here goes. Kelvin Winston Sobers, also known to the family as Rusty, was born 27th of October 1947 in Joseph Hill, St. Lucie. He was the only son of Rita Sobers, who was later married and became Gil. Rita, as she was affectionately known, had three children. Kelvin was the only boy, and he had an older sister, my mom, Glendora Cumberbatch, and a younger sister, Muriel Sobers. Muriel passed away in 2017. So having buried her baby sister, my mom is here today to bury her baby brother. From all reports, as a boy, Kelvin growing up was a typical boy. In fact, some might say that he was more than a typical boy. He might have been hard ears with some to spare. As the lone male in the family and an extended family loaded with females, Kelvin found very interesting ways to amuse himself and even more interesting ways to escape from home to play with the other males in the neighborhood. He spent a lot of time, like the other boys in the neighborhood, at the Spring Hall Plantation, where there was an operational mill for grinding canes at the time. Now, it was perhaps the lack of males in the family that endeared Kelvin to his cousin Ulrich Jokes. Now, for in Ulrich, he had a male relative to create mischief with. Ulrich was extremely fond of Kelvin and viewed him as a bigger brother, because like Kelvin, Ulrich too was the only male of his mother's four children. So in each other, they formed a bond that has only now been broken by death. As boys growing up, Kelvin looked out for Ulrich, and with Kelvin around, Ulrich had no worries about getting into quarrels and fights. After all, he knew that Kelvin was there, had his back. Then Kelvin moved to St. Michael to live with a great aunt, and Ulrich later moved to the United States. The bond of their friendship remained intact. In fact, over the years, Kelvin would have visited Ulrich in the United States on many occasions. He would have visited him for months at a time, and as a carpenter, he helped Ulrich with many extensions and alterations to his home. Now, Ulrich had made a vow that as long as he had it or knew anything that Kelvin needed, Kelvin would get it. He made sure that Kelvin had the latest in clothes, equipment, and tools to do his carpentry. He also made sure that he had the latest in gadgets and gizmos that were available. The first time I ever saw an MP3 player, Kelvin had it, and it was a gift from Ulrich. The last time Kelvin visited Ulrich in the United States was in 2019. And on this trip, he told Ulrich it would be the last time he would be visiting him in the United States. As fate would have it, COVID happened, and now he has passed. So indeed, it was his final time, it was his final visit to the States. It was because of COVID that Ulrich too was unable to visit Barbados. And it meant that the last time they would have seen each other in person was indeed in 2019. Ulrich is indeed deeply moved by Kelvin's passing, and regrettably, despite his best efforts and some uncertainty, he could not make it home for his funeral. However, he sends from his wife Lisa, his sons Ivan and James, and himself deepest sympathy and fondest regards to all of us who, like him, are mourning Kelvin's passing. After moving to Christchurch, Kelvin met and later married Mahalia Vida Brown on the 25th of March 1972. And 25 years later, in 1997, they renewed their marital vows. They lived together in their home in Clapham until Vida's passing in 2008. In Vida, Kelvin had a wife that treated him like a king. She waited on him hand and foot as though he was indeed a king, and turned his house into a home, outfitting it in such a way that its decor resembled a hotel. She ensured that they were able to own the land on which the house was built and that the home was well maintained. Though they had no children of their own, they opened their homes to both short and long stay visits from relatives on both sides of the families. I myself would have visited and stayed for short periods. Family members in Josie Hill could count on Kelvin's assistance whenever major projects involving his skills as a carpenter were to be undertaken. In the early days, he rolled in on his motorcycle with a cigarette tucked behind his ear and a matchstick in his hair. All of us have our idiosyncrasies, and two things I will always remember about Kelvin. Well, there are a couple others, but I can take the two that I can speak of in this audience. Were Kelvin's smoking and Kelvin eating pepper sauce by the spoonful. Couldn't imagine. Anyhow, it was Kelvin's smoking habit that had caused his grandmother and my great-grandmother to say to me that it takes two things to smoke a cigarette. She identified fire at one end and an ass at the other. And then she turned to me and she said, "You really don't look like fire, so I won't see you smoking any cigarettes." I've never smoked a cigarette. As the years passed, Kelvin graduated from motorcycles to cars, and then his visits to St. Lucie included him coming to take relatives to the beach or to the various plantations for potatoes or yams or whatever produce were available. His car was also one of the many ways he helped people, as often he provided transportation for people to get from one place to another. Now, after Kelvin's final visit to the United States in 2019, and the family in St. Lucie recognized that he was indeed getting down. He wasn't moving as brisk as he used before. He had a pronounced bow walk and was really struggling. And we suggested to Kelvin that he move back to St. Lucie to be with his family, where we could care for him. We all tried unsuccessfully to persuade him. We were mindful that it would be difficult for any of us living in St. Lucie to give him the kind of care and support he might need. In hindsight, it is understandable why he was reluctant to move back to St. Lucie. He would have spent most of his life in Clapham, and leaving his marital home, which I am sure housed many memories for him, was something he was not prepared to do, especially knowing all he and his wife would have invested in building a house and creating a home. It meant that for his family members in St. Lucie, most of whom are also aging, it was difficult to provide a level of care for Kelvin. Communication was restricted to telephone conversations, mostly when he called, because often when we called, he never answered. This may have been attributed to his problematic hearing or the fact that his phone calls were being monitored. Contrary to things that have been attributed to him, Kelvin loved his family dearly, especially his sister. There isn't anything he would not have done for his dear Lean. And his family loved and cared for him deeply also. Hence, that was our desire to have him return to St. Lucie where we could care for him. Conversations with his sister were always jovial, and he openly and freely spoke about how he was doing. When he had appointments at the clinic and they could not reach him, as the next of kin, the nurses would contact my mother, and she would call repeatedly until she was able to reach him. In the months before he passed, Kelvin became very hard to reach. And if we were able to speak to him, he said very little about how he was doing, and this became a little concerning for us. Now, I was overseas in October last year when the family received a photo of Kevin lying on a bed, visibly distressed. And on my return to the island, I visited him straight from the airport. I was indeed saddened by the state he was in, and I was told that it was because he wasn't eating and he had a stomach infection. I took my mommy to visit him the next day, the 27th of October, as this was his birthday and his 75th birthday, and I felt that she needed to see him, as I had some concerns. Regrettably, the level of suspicious attention mommy received when she visited were unfounded and disturbing. After a short stay in the Queen Elizabeth Hospital, where he was seemingly doing better, despite a visitor feeding him sweetbread, which should not have been happening, Kevin died in his home on the morning of the 17th of November, a few days after leaving the hospital. And this happened at a time when his sister and I were preparing to go and get him and bring him to St. Lucie to take care of him as he lived alone. Was it a twist of fate? Was it divine intervention? Whatever it was, hindsight being absolutely perfect vision, and the God we serve being as awesome as he is, Kevin died before we got the opportunity to get him, and today we are here to commit his mortal remains to eternal rest. When I visited Kevin on my return, he told me he was ready to go. This was painful to hear, coming from a man who always was full of life and excited to do stuff, whether he was able to or not. During another visit, he told me he wanted to be buried at Christchurch Cemetery, where his wife Vita was interred back in 2008. He further requested that Anderson Funeral Home handle his funeral arrangements. He also requested a graveside ceremony. Today we are honoring these requests. He also made some additional requests, which I will do all in my power to ensure are honored. Like all of us, Kevin had his ways, a lot of them good, some of them bad, but he was a very kind, loving, and supportive of his family. And at every stage in his life, he showed this with his actions. It is therefore very unfortunate that anyone should seek to discredit or discount his relationship with his family and his outstanding family for their own malicious gain. Kelvin, Uncle, you and only you refer to me as Fox. What was the origin of that alias? I never knew. I never asked. However, I will not allow that nickname to die with you. And for you, Kelvin, I will strive to live up to everything you ever expected of me when you bestowed that nickname, Fox, on me. Kelvin, brother, nephew, uncle, cousin, rest in peace, my good man, and rise in glory. Thank you.
I speak to you this morning in the name of God the Father and God the Son and God the Holy Spirit. Amen. Part of the second verse of the 14th chapter of the Gospel according to St. John, which was read earlier. I go to prepare a place for you. I go to prepare a place for you. St. John's Gospel, chapter 14, and part of the second verse. My dear brothers and sisters, there's a popular song which tells us that this world is not our home. We are just like pilgrims passing through this world. And someday we will have to leave this world behind us. But St. John this morning reminds us that Jesus has gone to prepare a place for us, so that when we leave this world, we shall live with him in glory everlasting. And I need to remind you this morning that there is a place, there is a room being prepared for each and every one of us. The Virgin of the lesson read this morning tells us that there are resting places. Another Virgin tells us that there are rooms. And the King James Virgin tells us that they are mansions. And I love the King James Virgin. I love to hear that there is a mansion being prepared for each and every one of us. And why love that Virgin? Because in this world that we are living in, none of us here this morning, I believe, will be able to live in a mansion. Mansions are for the rich and the famous in this world. And I believe that none of us is rich or famous. Yes, we may be rich spiritually, but materially, we are not rich. But thank God, there is a mansion being made ready for us. And this should be comforting to us, knowing that when we depart this world, with all the pain and suffering, the trials and tribulations, there is a place we will be going where Blessed John the Divine in Revelation chapter 7 tells us there will be no sickness, there will be no grief, there will be no pain, there will be no death. But brothers and sisters, there is that place where there will be joy, joy unspeakable and full of glory, because we will be in the presence of Almighty God. And we are reminded by the psalmist that in the presence of God, there's what? There's fullness of joy. And at his right hand are pleasures forevermore. Jesus spoke these words to his disciples in the upper room at what is referred to as the Last Supper, his farewell supper, on the night before he was crucified. He was speaking to them about his coming death. And he realized that there was that sorrow on their faces. And he looked at them, and what did he say to them? My disciples, why are you worried? Let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, he says. Believe also in me. And then he went on to say to them, in my Father's house are many mansions. And he didn't stop there. He said to them, I go to prepare a place for you. I want to say to you this morning that Jesus is preparing a place for each and every one of us. And when he's finished preparing that place, he will return. He will come again. For he tells us, if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again. Yes, my brothers and sisters, Jesus is coming again to receive us and to take us unto himself, so that where he is, there we shall be also. Isn't that good to know? That someday we shall be with the Lord Jesus Christ in glory everlasting. And I'm sure that that is a place that each and every one of us would want to live in. And the good news to each and every one of us this morning is that we can all live in that mansion that is being prepared for us. But my friends, if we are to live in that mansion, we must prepare ourselves for that beautiful place. Jesus, our risen and ascended Savior, is doing his part. He is making preparation for us. And we need also to do our part. We need to make preparation for him. We need to prepare ourselves so that when he comes that second time, we will be among those he will be coming to receive. But someone may ask me, how can I prepare myself to go with Jesus when he comes? And I'm saying to you, my brothers and sisters, that we can prepare ourselves by first loving the Lord Jesus. And I believe that all of us here love Jesus. Am I right? Yes. All of us here this morning love Jesus. So that is the first thing we must do. We must love him. And after loving him, we must serve him. We must praise him. For my brothers and sisters, he is worthy of praise from each and every one of us, from the rising of the sun unto the going down of the same thereof. No wonder the psalmist, in the very last verse of his last psalm, says that everything that hath breath, do what? Praise the Lord. My friends, the dead can't praise God. The dead cannot praise God. It is the living. And so if we are to occupy that mansion that is being prepared for us, we must love Jesus and we must praise him. Yes, we will have our trials and our tribulations. There will be stumbling blocks and obstacles placed in our path as we journey through this world. We will have our share of trials and tribulations, but Jesus tells us that because he suffered, we too shall suffer. Yes, my friends, Jesus reminds us that there's a cross for each and every one of us. And you know, cross bearing isn't easy. And my cross may not be like your cross. Your cross may not be like my cross. But regardless of who we are, we all have a cross to carry. And as I said, it is not easy. Take Jesus as our example. As Jesus took that cross up the hill to Calvary, Scripture tells us that he fell 3 times under the weight of that cross. But my friends, thank God this morning, Jesus did not remain down. For if Jesus had remained down, then we would not be in an arrangement like this morning. But he knew that the destiny of this sinful world depended on him going to Calvary. And so each time he fell, he got up and he went on until he reached the summit of Calvary. You know what happened to him there? Our Jesus was stretched out on a hard wooden cross. Those nails were driven into his hands and his feet, crushing his bones and ripping away the flesh as they were driven in. That sword pierced his side, from which came water and blood. A crown of thorns was placed on his head, all for you and for me. Jesus went to Calvary, as the songwriter says, all the way to Calvary. He went for me. But as I said, he fell 3 times. We too shall fall under the weight of our cross. As we journey through this world, we too shall fall under the weight of our cross. But thank God, Jesus is journeying with us. And each time we fall, he is there saying to us, just get up, my brother. Get up, my sister. For my friends, if we do not get up, then we will not reach that mansion that is being prepared for us. And so I say to you this morning, as you journey through this world, like the psalmist David, keep your eyes fixed on God. Look to Jesus. Let Jesus be your focus. For as long as you journey through this world with your eyes fixed on Jesus, then you will overcome all the obstacles and stumbling blocks. We fail. Yes, we fail. Because we take our eyes off Jesus. In closing, I want to point you to those disciples. You remember the disciples on the Sea of Galilee that night when Jesus came walking to them on the water? You remember that story? And they thought it was a ghost. But when Jesus spoke, they realized. And Peter said, Lord, if it is you, bid me come to you walking on the water. Jesus, Lord, Peter had a lot of mouth too, you know. He said, well, you got a doubt, come. And you know, Peter stepped out. He started to walk on the water. But when he saw the winds and the waves, he took his eyes off Jesus and focused on the winds and the waves. And then he started to sink. I'm saying to you, if we take our eyes off Jesus, we too shall sink in all our trials and our tribulations. Let us keep our eyes fixed on Jesus as we go through this world. For he is the one who will enable us to overcome all our obstacles and stumbling blocks. He is the only one who will enable us to go through this life and to occupy that home in glory everlasting. And so this morning, as we give God thanks for the life, the work, and witness of our brother Kelvin, we pray that God will have mercy on his soul and grant him a place with all his saints in glory everlasting. And now to all his sovereign relatives, his sister, his nephew, cousins, other relatives and friends, I extend to you deepest sympathy. Rest eternal grant to him, O Lord. Let light perpetual shine upon him. May he rest in peace. Amen. Shall we pray? Grant us, Lord, the wisdom and the grace to use aright the time that is left us here on earth. Lead us, O God, to repent of our sins, the evil we have done, and the good we have failed to do. And strengthen us to follow the steps of your Son in a way that leads to the fullness of eternal life through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, with whom still live the spirits of those who die in the Lord, and with whom the souls of the faithful are in joy and felicity, we give you heartfelt thanks for the good examples of all your servants, who having finished their course in faith, now find rest and refreshment. May we, for all who have died in the true faith of your holy name, have perfect fulfillment and bliss in your eternal and everlasting glory, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Grant, O Lord, to all who are bereaved the spirit of faith and courage, that they may have strength to meet the days to come with steadfastness and patience, not sorrowing as those without hope, but in thankful remembrance of your great goodness, and in a joyful expectation of eternal life with those they love. And this we ask in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Rest eternal grant to him, O Lord. Let light perpetual shine upon him. May he and all the faithful departed through the mercy of God rest in peace. Amen. The Lord bless him and keep him. The Lord make his face to shine upon him and be gracious to him. The Lord lift up his countenance upon him and give him peace, both now and forevermore. Amen. And unto him that is able to keep us from falling and to present his faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy, to the only wise God, our Savior, be glory and majesty, dominion and power, both now and forevermore. Amen. Let us now sing the hymn, To God Be the Glory.
Thank you.
In the name of God the Father, and God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Amen. Everyone the Father gives to me will come to me. I will never turn away anyone who believes in me. I heard a voice from heaven saying, write this, happy are the dead who die in the faith of Christ. Henceforth says the Spirit, they may rest from their labors, for they take with them the record of their deeds. Man born of woman has but a short time to live. Like a flower, he blossoms and then withers. Like a shot, he flees and never stays. In the midst of life, we are in death. To whom can we turn for help but you, Lord, who are justly angered by our sins? Lord God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal, holy and most merciful Savior, deliver us from the bitter pains of eternal death. You know the secrets of our hearts. In your mercy, hear our prayer, forgive us our sins, and at our last hour, let us not fall away from you. Ensuring certain hope of resurrection to eternal life. To our Lord Jesus Christ, we commend to Almighty God our brother Calvin Winston, and we commit his body to the ground, earth to earth, ashes to ashes, dust to dust. And we beseech you in your infinite goodness to give us grace to live in your dear love and to die in your favor, that when your well-beloved Son shall come again in judgment, both this, our brother, Calvin Winston, and we ourselves may be found acceptable in your sight. Grant this for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, Hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive them that trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Amen. Rest eternal grant to him, O Lord. Let light perpetual shine upon him. May he rest in peace. Amen. The hymn, Blessed Assurance, Jesus is Mine. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound. the sweet by and by. What a friend we have in Jesus.
Thank you.
with you. Let us pray. O Lord, support us all the day long of this troublous life, until the shades lengthen and the evening comes and the busy world is hushed. The fever of life is over and our work is done. Then, Lord, in mercy, grant us safe lodging, a holy rest, and peace at the last, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Rest eternal grant to him, O Lord, let light perpetual shine upon him. May his soul and the souls of all the faithful departed through the mercy of God rest in peace. Amen. Thank you all very much, and may God continue to bless you and keep you. Thank you.
You can do your breathing and take your time and move with you.